Welcome everyone to the 16th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2022. I've received no apologies for today's meeting. We have some members joining us remotely though, so it's a hybrid meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 5 and 6 in private. Are members agreed? With agreed, thank you. And our second item today is an evidence session with the Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport on tackling alcohol harms in Scotland. This follows a session on Tuesday, the 1st of March 2022, where the committee took evidence on the same topic from Alcohol Focus Scotland, Public Health Scotland and Scottish Health Action on Alcohol Problems. The Minister is joined by her supporting officials. Now, welcome to the committee, Millie Todd, Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport. Good morning, Minister. And Amy Kirkpatrick, the Head of Alcohol Harm Prevention, and Maggie Page, the Unit Head of the Drug Strategy Unit for the Scottish Government, are joining us online. And I invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. Our Chief Medical Officer has said that a healthier population could be one of our nation's most important assets and must be our ambition. To achieve this, we must focus on addressing health inequalities and their detrimental effects. The negative effects of poverty, trauma and discrimination on an individual's mental and physical health can't be ignored. And it's for all these reasons that we have increased funding in tackling problematic alcohol and drug use. It's also why we need to consult on potential restrictions on alcohol advertising and review the level of minimum unit price. Minimum unit price was introduced in 2018 and we're in the final year of our five-year evaluation period. 12 months after minimum unit price was introduced, we saw a decrease of 2% in alcohol sales in the off-trade. We also saw a decrease in alcohol-specific deaths of 10%, the largest decrease since 2012. Then the pandemic hit. And there's evidence to show that some groups who were already drinking at dangerous levels were drinking more, despite alcohol sales falling overall. We do not yet know if the increased deaths reported in 2020 will be echoed in 2021. We can't prejudge what the minimum evaluation of minimum unit price will say. We're not yet in a position to indicate whether the current level of 50 pence per unit should be changed, and if it does, what that change would be. Any price must be supported by robust evidence. It's important that we review the attractiveness of alcohol. Attractiveness is one of the World Health Organization's three best buys for countries to prevent and reduce alcohol-related harms. We know that children and young people in Scotland are seeing a staggering amount of alcohol advertising and promotion in a variety of ways. A survey in 2018 of over 3,000 young people aged 11 to 19 found that half of those surveyed had seen at least 32 instances of alcohol marketing within a month. That's at least one instance a day, and I'm sure we would all agree that that is simply too high. Seeing alcohol advertising and promotion can influence the attitudes that children and young people have towards alcohol, especially when this is cast as fun, sociable or cool. We know that there is a direct link between exposure to alcohol marketing and children and young people starting to drink alcohol, and this can increase the likelihood that they will drink in ways that can be risky or harmful in later life. I personally find this deeply troubling, and I'm determined to cut down on the volume of alcohol advertising and promotion that young people see and to reduce the appeal that alcohol has to them. And that's why we're planning on consulting on a range of new measures to restrict alcohol advertising and promotion in Scotland in the autumn. This consultation will be vital in helping us to consider whether new legislation is needed. We know that alcohol-related harms are as an important issue as drug-related harms. Both are significant public health emergencies. And that's why we've set our national mission to improve lives and save lives, at the core of which is ensuring that every individual is able to access the treatment and recovery that they choose. Increased investment from the National Mission on Tackling Drug-Related Deaths has been used by alcohol and drug partnerships across Scotland to support people facing problems because of alcohol and drug use. However, more can still be done to get people into appropriate treatment quicker in order to reduce harms and to help our recovery. There should be no shame in reaching out for support, and the voices of those with lived and living experience are critical to this process. We're working with the UK government and the other devolved administrations on reviewing and updating clinical guidelines for alcohol treatment. The guidance will look to introduce new approaches to treatment and support the development of alcohol-specific treatment targets. We're working with Public Health Scotland on reviewing the evidence on current delivery of alcohol brief interventions. This work is in the really early stages, but it's critical to ensuring that alcohol brief interventions are as effective as possible. And we're exploring the evidence around managed alcohol programmes and are delighted to be able to contribute to the running of the model being piloted in Glasgow by the Simon Community Scotland and its evaluation. I'm under no illusions that there is still a lot to be done, but I am determined, with your help, to improve the nation's health, to tackle health inequalities by implementing these bold approaches to reduce the significant harms of alcohol. And I also hope I can count on support from across Parliament in tackling the harmful impact of alcohol marketing when the consultation launches. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. I mean, you've gone through quite a wide range of measures that you're implementing. I want to take us back to the trends. So you mentioned about the trends before the pandemic, and quite a lot of measures could be said to have been working. We have a reduction in alcohol deaths, and things seem to be moving in the right direction. And then, of course, the pandemic comes along, and as with everything else, some things happen as a result of that. And you said that there's been less consumption of alcohol, but of course, the type of alcohol consumption that's been happening has probably been of the less social side and more of the at home. And it's affecting particular demographics from what we hear. So I really want to ask you, I mean, what things that you perhaps have been doing up until the pandemic you're continuing on with, but in the future, how are you prioritising in order to deal with the trends that have occurred since the pandemic and the potential alcohol harms that have happened since the pandemic to those particular demographics?
So you're absolutely correct, Convener, that there has been quite a disruption caused by the pandemic in this area, as in many other. And what we've seen is a steadily reducing amount of alcohol consumed. We saw in the first year of after introduction of minimum unit pricing of alcohol, a huge decrease in the number of deaths, 10%. It was, I think, the second largest decrease in a year since records began. In 2020, that's the first year of the pandemic, adults drank an average of 9.4 litres of alcohol per head, which is 18 units per adult per week. And that's the lowest level of average alcohol consumption in Scotland for 26 years. But it's still nearly 30% more than the recommended limits. And what that doesn't tell us is who was drinking and how they were drinking. So there's a real suspicion that what happened was that people who were drinking heavily before the pandemic consumed more during the pandemic, and those who were drinking less drank less. So there was also a big shift in where we drank. Remember, because of lockdown, there was a lot less drinking alcohol in bars and a lot more consumption of alcohol at home. There were also changes in the level of admissions to hospital and an increase in the number of deaths. And, you know, you would think if there was an increasing number of deaths, there would be an increasing number of admissions to hospital. But actually, we saw the opposite, and that may be about the level of strain that was being experienced across the healthcare system at that time. So we've a lot to disentangle and understand about what happened during the pandemic. We also don't know whether that's a one-off or whether that's going to alter the trend going forward. What we did see, I mean, there's one crumb of comfort in all of this, and it's not comfortable, I have to say, at all. Each of these deaths is an absolute tragedy, and and the deaths, 23 deaths per week, is only the tip of the iceberg. So those are the deaths that are directly attributable to alcohol. There's also a large number of deaths related to heart disease and cancer, of which alcohol is a contributory factor. So it is an absolutely tragic situation, but the one crumb of comfort is that we did see, although Scotland has a long-standing harmful, you know, recognised harmful relationship with alcohol, we did see that Scottish people drank more during more Scottish people died of alcohol during the pandemic. We also saw that increase happen right across the UK, so it wasn't something that was unique to Scotland. And actually, our rise of 17% was slightly lower than the rest of the UK country. So that gives me a hope that perhaps some of the work and strategies that we have in place were protective during that difficult time. So I think minimum unit of pricing of alcohol may have meant that whilst we had a devastating increase in the number of deaths that year, we didn't have quite the same level as they had in the rest of the UK. Minimum unit pricing of alcohol isn't the only string in feather in our cap, though. We've done a lot of work over a number of years. When you have a nation with such a harmful relationship with a substance like alcohol, you have to do more than one thing to try to tackle it. So we've taken a whole range of actions to reduce the availability, attractiveness, affordability of alcohol in line with the World Health Organization's recommended approach. And we're going to continue that on, you know, taking that whole population approach, which aims to reduce alcohol consumption. It aims to reduce the risk of alcohol-related harms right across the population. We've got two consistent threads running through our work, though, and two target areas that we're really keen to be focused on. And that's one, that our actions have to reduce health inequalities and we have to protect children and young people. So what we're planning on going forward, we're consulting on potential restrictions on alcohol advertising, as I said, and promotion, particularly to protect children and young people. We're keen to give consumers information on labels, health information, such as the placing of the 14 units recommendation on cans. We're also discussing on a Four Nations basis, putting calorie labelling onto alcohol. We think that will be helpful. And we've twice over the course of the pandemic run our Count 14 campaign, worked to raise awareness of all four of the UK CMOs, lower risk drinking guidelines of 14 units per week for the 4 weeks in March, twice in the last few years. So for the 4 weeks in March 2019, and we did it for 6 weeks in January to March 2020.
Thank you. And my colleague's going to pick up on quite a lot of the things that you've mentioned there. I guess I'm interested to hear about the measurement, which could be a false measurement, about the hospital admissions during the pandemic, because of course we can't make any assumptions on that basis. For the work going forward to identify people who perhaps have got into problem areas of, in terms of their drinking is one thing, but you also mentioned young people and the next generation coming through. And I don't want to sort of go into some of my colleagues' areas around the kind of advertising aspect of things. But in terms of that relationship, I mean, we've been really trying for many, many years to try and tackle the kind of causes of that relationship and how that relationship with alcohol that Scotland seems to have continues. And the best way of doing that is to change that relationship at the point where people are starting to drink. I mean, in that area, I mean, what's the Scottish Government doing to assist changing that relationship that young people have towards, or that attitude that young people have towards drinking, which could lead to problem drinking in later adulthood?
So I think that all of the work that we've done so far, so if you think about minimum unit pricing, reducing affordability, I think that will help. They'll see less drinking in society. But I think one of the main areas that we need to go into is our alcohol advertising and promotion. The Children, that's Young Scot, the Children's Parliament and the Youth Parliament did this amazing report a couple of years ago, which really made very shocking reading, actually. And they came to the Parliament and presented it. So from the mouths of babes, you heard directly how much alcohol they were exposed to. And alcohol is ubiquitous in our children's lives. And it's not just the advertising, but advertising is a big part of it. They talk very clearly about, you know, when they open the fridge door in the morning to get their milk out, there's a stack of wine in the fridge. They and if you think about how our drinking has changed as a nation since, say, the 1970s when I grew up, when it wasn't very common to drink at home and people didn't really drink wine with dinner, children nowadays are seeing a great deal more alcohol being consumed at home. They see alcohol advertising on transport. They see alcohol advertising on billboards on the way into school. And this is, you know, a point that I've made here at this committee before, is that you can't just protect children from alcohol advertising by throwing a ring around where children are. So you can't just, you know, prevent alcohol advertising around a school. Children are in our society and they see these billboards and these adverts as they navigate their way to school. The other thing was, you know, they see advertising in the cinema, they see advertising on the television, they see advertising. I mean, there was a shocking study that was done on the amount of adverts children were exposed to in sports promotions. And I'll find the statistic and make sure I get it correct, but essentially, when children are watching sports, again, literally a couple of times a minute, they are seeing alcohol advertising. And that is particularly harmful because these are heroes to children. Sorry, I'm not sure what the noise is.
To happen every a lot of broadcasting picks it up. I think it's to do with the central heating, so I apologise for that. It's away now. Thank you, Minister, for managing to make your way through that noise. I'm going to pass on to Deputy Convener Paul O'Kane. Paul.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the Minister. I wonder if I could just ask a wee bit more in terms of the government's 2018 alcohol framework. There's a lot in there, and I think committee are keen to hear about progress. And I suppose I'm particularly interested looking at action points 9 and 15 about the requirement, I suppose, for close working with UK government and the acknowledgement that we obviously have to have collaboration there. So I'm keen to perhaps understand from the Minister what interactions, meetings have taken place since 2018. Obviously, we appreciate there's been 2 years of pandemic, but it would be good to get a sense of what progress the Minister feels has been made.
So certainly, and I'll potentially bring Amy in to give a bit more detail, because quite a lot of these meetings are happening at official level. But there are two areas that spring to mind that we are working on together. One is developing clinical guidelines for the treatment of alcohol misuse. And the other area is in terms of labelling. We're very keen to get a four-nation approach to labelling, both including health messages like the CMO's recommendation for 14 units per week, but also in terms of calorie labelling for alcohol products. But I'll ask Amy to tell you a little bit more about the way that that interaction between the governments occurs.
I'll bring in Amy.
We regularly meet on a Four Nations approach to discuss alcohol harm reduction. We meet also with Wales quite regularly. As you may know, they've just recently brought in minimum unit pricing, so we talk quite a lot about that. But as the Minister said, we are quite focused on the calorie labelling and on the, not my area, but on the treatment side, the board, UK treatment guidelines.
Thank you. Paul?
Thank you very much. That's useful. And I think, I suppose, if I can perhaps just expand on the calorie labelling guidelines. I mean, this is a kind of key ask, I think, of many of the third sector and wider organisations that we've taken evidence from in the past. And I wonder if the Minister might want to say anything about what progress she feels is being made, because I think there is a sense perhaps that progress has been too slow to try and get that consensus, if you like. And I think the Minister alluded to it in her opening remarks around how ubiquitous I think alcohol is. And I think part of that is through, not just advertising, but also what information is out there in terms of labelling and standards and those sorts of things. So I wonder if a particular comment on that progress.
So I think, I mean, I would agree with our stakeholders. I think progress has been disappointing. I'm not entirely sure why. The consultation has been delayed by the UK government, and we don't know when the UK plan to run that consultation. We're very keen to work on a four-nation basis, and we're very keen for the consultation to be to be across the UK. We think that's the most effective way. I mean, we've learned a lot about public health over the course of the pandemic, and we've learned it is. Where possible, working on a four-nation basis is absolutely the best way forward. So we are also very disappointed that the UK government have stalled on that consultation. And despite attempts to get clarity on the timetable, we haven't got it. So I'm disappointed to report I can't tell you when that is likely to happen.
Thank you, Paul. Any more questions or can I move on?
No, thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. We now want to dig in a little bit deeper into minimum unit pricing. Questions from David Torrance. David.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. The Scottish Government was committed to a review of minute unit pricing after 2 years, but it was delayed by pandemic. And in your opening statement, you said it was a five-year review and we're now in 4 years. Can you update the committee on how it's progressing?
So I can. We're work on reviewing the level of minimum unit prices underway. It's really important work, and we need to carry it out thoroughly to ensure that any change to the level has a robust evidence base. Just as important as the review of the level of minimum unit pricing is the need to ensure that minimum unit pricing continues as a policy. That's the sunset clause. If you remember, when the legislation was passed, a sunset clause was built in. So the Act requires that the Scottish Ministers lay a report before the Scottish Parliament as soon as practical after 5 years. So that's the 30th of April next year. We've just passed the four-year anniversary, actually, on the 1st of May since the introduction of the minimum unit price. So we are doing both of these reviews simultaneously, but the focus has to be on the five-year review because there is legislation in place that is strict around that timetable. There are also other things. I mean, we know that the pandemic's changed our behaviour, so we've changed the way that we drink, and we need to better understand that, I think, when we're thinking about minimum unit price. We also know that the cost of living crisis, so we were very keen that the minimum unit price should reflect affordability, as the World Health Organization is clear, rather than simply cost or price. So the fact that people's household costs have increased so substantially will have an impact on how we interpret how we review the minimum unit price. And the final change that's happened is the Internal Market Act, which has changed the landscape on how, there was a lot of discussion as that legislation went through Parliament. The Scottish Parliament did not consent to it, but that may well have changed our ability to take public health measures in Scotland that are different from the rest of the UK.
Minister, it's 10 years since 50 pence was first proposed as a minimum unit price. In evidence to a committee, it was argued that it should be automatically uprated with inflation rather than having to go to review or to legislation. What is your feelings on that?
So I think this time, I mean, I've alluded to the level of complexity this time. I think we really need to, and I think we need to have a robust evidence base as we review it. I'm not going to automatically assume that we uplift it, but we, as we review the minimum unit price, I think there needs to be a really robust approach and a solid evidence base informing that decision. And a lot has changed, a lot more than we anticipated has changed. However, I do think it is attractive for us to consider some sort of automatic uplift. So I am not convinced. I talked about the challenge with linking to linking to inflation. I don't think that would really capture the issue of affordability, because inflation is going up, but so is cost of living. So people have a lot less money in their pockets to spend in alcohol right at this moment in time. We're spending a great deal more on energy, and we're spending, you know, highest taxes that since the 1950s. So I think we do need to look at affordability. I think it is perfectly possible for us to find a way to do it, that, and to do that automatically, because I think to be effective, it probably does need to be reviewed on a more regular basis than it has been.
Thank you, Minister. Brexit, and you mentioned the internal UK market earlier on there in your statement. How could that affect Scotland and the Scottish Government in trying to implement health measures against alcohol?
So, one of the obvious areas would be labelling, for example. So we are very keen in Scotland to have both the 14-week recommendation and calorie labelling on alcohol. Should we choose not to proceed with that on a four-nations basis, should England choose to do things differently, if a product was passed as suitable for sale in England, it could be sold in Scotland as well. And that would really weaken my ability, or our ability as a government and our ability as a parliament, to take public health decisions in Scotland for Scotland, which is, you know, one of the very well-rehearsed arguments that we had at the time of that bill passing. So there's an obvious example.
Thank you. No further question.
A few members wanting to ask you some questions on minimum unit pricing. Stephanie?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. I wanted to ask you about the industry itself there. Now, clearly, previously there were some arguments about them being concerned about the industry going to the wall, about people heading down to England to fill their boots up with lots of alcohol, people turning to other drugs as well. And none of those things seem to have happened, which obviously is really good and really, really positive. But I'm wondering, has there been any indication from industry that there would be a challenge to any further increase in minimum unit price? And in fact, I'll leave it at that one and then I'll come back in with another question.
So I haven't had a direct indication from industry, but I suppose one of the things that I regularly say in life is the biggest predictor, the best, most solid predictor of the future is the past. So if we look at what happened in the past, I think that will give us a reasonably solid idea of potentially what could happen going forward. This is an industry, a multi-million pound global industry, which will want to protect its interests.
Thank you, Minister. Certainly we know it's an incredibly powerful industry. And I'm wondering as well, are you preempting any kind of new arguments? Or are you just expecting it to be very similar to last time? Because really, the evidence is saying, you know, what they predicted to happen really didn't happen. I'm just wondering if there has been anything else, any new ideas that have been brought to the table about additional concerns that they have now moving forward, and any evidence that they might be relying on for that.
So I haven't heard any particularly new arguments. And as you say, some of the evidence has been quite comforting, I would say, for the industry. So it showed that there hasn't been displacement to more harmful drugs. People are still buying alcohol, although less, but actually that's one of the, you know, really sophisticated aspects of this policy, is that profits don't go down. So people aren't, you know, industries aren't harmed by it. So that's one of the things to admire about it. We are looking very carefully at all of the evidence, and Public Health Scotland are publishing evidence as we go along, but it won't be till the end where we have, you know, the full data and analysis from the full 5 years that we are really able to draw conclusions about the solid, and it will be a solid and robust body of evidence that's built up. I think, for those of us who were convinced about it, if I think back to the introduction of this policy, I was a health professional when this policy was introduced. I was working in a psychiatric hospital, and I was excited at the idea of a sophisticated, clever public health policy that would target, in such a specific way, harmful drinking. And I expected it to work, and the evidence, I mean, clearly this Parliament expected it to work or we wouldn't have passed it. The evidence is reasonably robust and solid, and certainly pre-pandemic was pointing in the right direction. But I think we need the full evaluation to make decisions going forward. And you know, the alcohol industry is not going to shape public health policy, but I'm more than happy to hear any concerns that they might have.
That's great, Minister. Thank you.
Sue, you have a question?
Yes, thank you, Convener. You spoke there, Minister, regarding displacement. A report from the Institute of Economic Affairs has suggested that minimum unit pricing is responsible for a certain amount of displacement to higher value categories. MUPs resulted in an extra 8.2 million litres of pure alcohol being sold in the 50 to 64 pence per unit categories, and a further 400 litres being sold above the 70 pence per unit category. So what investigatory work has the Scottish Government commissioned into that level of that displacement? And do you recognise the argument that MUP has pushed consumers towards the mid-range rather than away from alcohol in its entirety?
So if you think about it, that's what the policy was intended to do. It was intended to make alcohol more expensive. What we found was, when we looked at things you could buy, you know, you could exceed the 14 unit per week recommendation for £2.50 before the introduction of minimum unit pricing. So that was the intention of the policy. That's not, I don't think, a downside of the policy. The intention was that it would be that people would have to spend more in order to buy each unit of alcohol. I may be oversimplifying this or not quite understanding your point, but isn't that what was meant to happen?
I thought one of the points was to reduce the amount of alcohol that people were drinking was also an intention from the policy. But all I'm suggesting is they're not. They're still drinking the same, if not more, just of those with a higher unit.
So what the study you've quoted shows is that people are buying more expensive alcohol. What other studies show is that at a population level, we are consuming less alcohol, lowest level of alcohol consumed by people in Scotland for 26 years. So per head of population, we are only consuming 18 units of alcohol per week. That still is in excess of the recommended 14 units, and it doesn't quite explain the whole picture, because within that there are some people who are abstinent or drink very little, and there are some people who are drinking very heavily. But at a population level, both of those things are true. We have reduced as a population the amount of alcohol that we drink, and that alcohol that we are buying to drink is costing us more. But that's what the World Health Organization said we had to do in order to tackle alcohol harm, was to make alcohol less affordable.
Thank you. Sandesh, do you have a question on this?
Before I come in on the question that I was going to ask, I want to come in what Sue was asking. Minister, you talked about other studies on the population level, but is it not true to say that those studies show that problem drinkers are actually drinking more through the pandemic? And is it also not true to say that those people without a problem drinking, those who are more, who are drinking more moderately, have actually significantly decreased? Is that not what those studies are showing? So what Sue was asking and what the population answer you gave, I don't think they quite match up.
So what I said is that we need to drill further into the statistics that we have from the first year of the pandemic. We need to understand. So the big picture is that the population drank less, and yet we know we had the highest level of alcohol deaths a 17% increase on the year before, which is absolutely tragic. So some people must have been drinking more, and we think that's a pandemic impact. We think that's largely explained by the people who were drinking heavily before the pandemic drank more during the pandemic. We need to understand that better. We need to understand whether it has persisted, so whether that was a one-off change in response to an emergency situation, or whether that has persisted. But we don't quite have the understanding of that, you know, what happened then yet. I think we'll need, well, certainly I'd be keen to see this year's data to see whether it's a trend that has stuck, or whether it's just a one-off related to particularly the initial lockdown where healthcare services were so seriously impacted by the pandemic.
No, absolutely. But you know, minimum alcohol pricing was brought in to address problem drinkers because, as you said, you could go over 14 units at £2.50. So it's the problem drinkers that we're really trying to target with minimum alcohol pricing, because those who are spending significantly more on that alcohol aren't affected by minimum alcohol pricing, whether they've got a problem with drinking or not. So it's that group which is drinking very cheaply that minimum alcohol pricing was trying to target. But it does seem that they have drunk more.
So I'll bring Amy in to see if she can add a little more detail or clarity to this. My understanding is that minimum unit pricing was a whole population measure. It wasn't just targeted at people who were drinking heavily. It was targeted at people who were drinking heavily. It was targeted at particularly young children and young people who were buying very cheap alcohol. And what we expected was this World Health Organization, which talk about the three best buys, one of which is affordability, was that if we made alcohol less affordable, there would be a shift, a general shift across the population. And what my understanding, and this is from my time working in mental health, is that a heavy alcohol drinking is a spectrum. So there are some people who are completely abstinent, some people who drink very little, there are people who drink, you know, more and more heavily until you get to problem drinking. And what the policy of minimum unit pricing did was shift our drinking to a safer point on that spectrum. So I firmly believe that there will be fewer people who run into the problem of alcohol dependency in future because we introduced minimum unit pricing in the past. We are seeing, and I don't think it's entirely down to minimum unit pricing, I mean, I think that, you know, this is the challenge when you look back, there's been a number of changes, but children nowadays drink less. Children and young people are less likely to drink and drink in fewer units of alcohol than they did even in our quite recent history. So our policies are having an impact both on the population and both on the problem drinkers. I'll ask Amy to come in and see if there's any more clarity she can add to it. I mean, one of the things I was slightly sceptical about when I first came across this policy was whether people who are seriously addicted to alcohol and for whom their life revolves around alcohol, would minimum unit pricing actually reduce the amount that they drink? And the evidence does suggest, certainly as we brought the policy in, the evidence around that was that even those people who were most seriously addicted to alcohol would reduce the amount that they were drinking. We're talking about 23 deaths a week, over 600 admissions to hospital every single week in Scotland last year. We have to tackle that. Amy.
Yeah, I think, as the Minister said, minimum unit pricing was introduced with two aims, population-wide and to tackle hazard and harmful drinkers. I think the evidence before the pandemic was that there was a decrease and there was some evidence to show it was helping. Obviously, that hasn't, as the Minister's already said, didn't continue during the first year of the pandemic. But we still need to understand that in more detail. There was other factors in that, as the Minister already indicated, with regard to the hospital admissions. And obviously access to services was impacted by the pandemic as well. So there was a number of factors involved in that increase in drug-related, alcohol-related deaths. that we don't fully understand yet. Public Health Scotland will be publishing a harmful drinker study in the coming weeks, where we hope to see and gain a better understanding of what actually happened and what's happened so far since the minimum unit price has been introduced.
Thank you. So, any changes to do with minimum unit price will become in front of this committee anyway, so we'll have ample opportunity in the future to drill in a lot deeper. But we do have to move on because a number of other things that members want to ask questions on. In terms of reducing attractiveness, Gillian Mackay, you have some questions.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Minister. I've spoken to football teams who have adopted a social responsibility approach to sponsorship and are moving away from associations with alcohol and gambling brands. This is obviously laudable, but they are in the minority, and teams that are facing difficult financial circumstances will probably be less likely to take this step. What are your thoughts with regards to encouraging sporting teams to gradually move away from alcohol sponsorship versus an overall ban? And do you recognise that a ban is probably the best and fastest way of ensuring the end of alcohol sponsorship? And is there a possibility of providing financial support to clubs, either in the event of a ban or to those who do end alcohol sponsorship?
So, women's football are a shining light in this area, and they have a very responsible policy. So they're actually sponsored by SHAP, I think, and they don't accept alcohol sponsoring. And that's a great thing. It would be great if all sports were like that. I think the World Health Organization are reasonably clear that actually voluntary codes don't work and that legislation is needed. Other countries in the world have brought in legislation. I think, well, France certainly has, although we've seen quite clever examples of how the industry gets around those the measures in France. So we're very mindful of that when we're considering any legislation here. And I think Ireland has either done it or is in the process of doing it. So that's where, and I think we've spoken about this before, that study where we looked at the Six Nations. Actually, the level of alcohol advertising and promotion that children were most exposed to was in the Scotland-England match. Rather than any of the other matches, because many of the other countries, both France and Ireland, already have measures in place to protect children from advertising during sporting events.
That's great. Thanks, Camille.
Thank you, Gillian. Carol, you wanted to ask some questions around this. We'll just get Carol.
Interested in this.
Thank you. So if you want to start again, Carol, we missed the start of your question.
Yeah. No bother. Apologies for that. Just saying good morning to people. Morning. I'm very interested in this theme of, I suppose, reduced visibility. And I wondered whether the government or any research had been done around reducing visibility very much in places that people who perhaps have problems impulse buy, such as supermarkets, and also that notion that this reduced visibility for children and young people other countries have gone down the route of not having alcohol in these sort of doors that people nip in and out, so that you go for milk, you don't necessarily see alcohol. So I just wondered if you have thought about that, or if there is any research that you are looking at on this.
So we're certainly, I'm open to any approach that I think will work, but there aren't currently any plans in place to adjust the licensing laws. But I don't think this is going to be, do this and the problem will go away. I think this, we're all accepting that the level of problem that we have in Scotland and the harmful relationship that we have with alcohol is probably going to take multiple measures over a good period of time to shift the culture so that we have a significantly healthier relationship with alcohol. I think you're right to talk about it not being just children and young people and impulse buying. In fact, the evidence would suggest that people who are in recovery struggle to see adverts for alcohol and take steps to avoid seeing adverts for alcohol. So there's another group in our society, in our community, who find it very hard to resist the lure, the attractiveness of alcohol as it's presented to us today. to not just children and young people.
Have you any other questions, Carol?
No, I just want to thank the Minister for that question. I'm hoping we could possibly come back on it. I think it is an issue that we should perhaps explore in Scotland. So thanks very much for that.
Absolutely. Always happy to work with you.
Minister, if I may, there's only certain things that the Scottish Government can do in relation to alcohol advertising, but some of it's also at UK level, particularly around the broadcast media. Are you aware of anything that's been done UK-wide in terms of television advertising?
So I'll perhaps get Amy to confirm this, but no, I'm not aware of anything about television advertising. I can't think. Amy, do you want to say what's happening on a Four Nations basis?
No, we're not aware either. Ms Todd did write the UK government in December pushing for them to look at advertising on TV streaming and in the cinemas. But we're not aware of any action being taken in that area as of yet. But should that develop, we will, of course, update the committee.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to move on to questions around reducing availability and alcohol licensing and questions from Sundesh.
Thank you. Minister, earlier you spoke about the WHO recommendations and price, and obviously availability is another key part of it. Now, we've heard and some of us have experienced the problems when it comes to granting licences. So councils feel, a lot of councils feel, that when they are presented with alcohol licensing, they can't say no to it because of worry of going to court and losing. I know Glasgow is doing particularly well when it comes to trying to look at this, but is there anything that the Scottish Government can do to strengthen the hand of councils around the country so that they can say no to people who present with licences?
So certainly, as I said, I'm more than willing to hear from councils or stakeholders or cross-party politicians if there are things that they think that we could do to support local authorities. Much of the licensing, as you know, it is in the hands of our local authorities, and that's in many ways so that they can, they can make decisions that are appropriate for their own communities, which is absolutely the right thing to do. But if there are any suggestions on what we could do to strengthen their ability to make decisions, then I'm more than happy to consider that.
I mean, my concern, I mean, and it's very important that we do let councils make those decisions, but my real concern is the fact that they can't say no. And that's not a position that I think we should be in. The council should be able to make a decision, not worried that they're going to go to court and lose and end up spending a vast amount of money trying to defend their decision.
So I suppose there's always a challenge. I mean, we're asking councils to make a decision based on balancing the rights of people who drink responsibly versus balancing the need to protect people who might be harmed by more ubiquitous availability. And there are five high-level licensing objectives: preventing crime and disorder, securing public safety, preventing public nuisance, protecting and improving public health, protecting children and young people from harm. And those licensing objectives are ranked equally. So I think it is... I think that councils already have the powers and they have the guidance on what it is they need to be considering as they make these decisions. Public health should be part of that consideration. And as I say, if there is a particular suggestion that you have that you want me to consider in terms of strengthening the hand of local licensing boards, then I'm more than happy to hear it.
What we need to be is to be in a position... So with everything that you've said, Minister, there, it seems it's reasonable that a council should be able to say no and justify it. But if we look up and down the country, that isn't happening because councillors are worried that they're going to be taken to court and they're going to lose that court case and cost the council a lot of money. And that cannot be the position we're in. We need to be in a position where councillors can say no.
Well, I mean, I think we are in a position where councillors can say no. They have considerable discretion to determine appropriate licensing arrangements according to their local priorities and circumstances and their legal advice. And I don't think it's appropriate for Scottish Government to intervene in those matters, certainly not in individual cases. As I've said repeatedly, if there is something that you think I need to do at Scottish Government level to strengthen their hand, but you know, we've seen our own experience has certainly been that this is alcohol industry is very well funded, it's global, it is quite likely that they'll use the law to challenge anything that impacts on their business. So that may well, you know, that really is a reality. But local authorities have responsibility to balance the needs of all of the people living in their local area and to come to the right decisions that are best for them. And I think they're best placed to do it. I don't think central government is best placed to do it.
Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener. In terms of specific measures, I think overprovision is one of those areas where we maybe could do a wee bit more. And obviously that falls under some of the areas that you just mentioned within the licensing arrangements. Do you believe there is a place to be able to strengthen overprovision as a reason for refusing licences under one of those current areas that you outlined in your answer to Sandesh Gulhani?
Yeah, certainly. So overprovision is a tool by which licensing boards can prevent new licensed premises openings in the areas where they consider that there are too many licensed premises already in operation. I think it is a valuable tool. I'm not sure if what you're asking is for me to support local authorities to use it more or encourage them. Certainly, you know, again, I think that is absolutely the way to consider these issues going forward. So again, I'll speak to officials. I don't know if either of my officials would have anything to say on that. I'll see if there's anything that we can consider within government already. We're not planning to change the licensing laws, but if there's anything I can do to support local authorities to be more confident in applying them and achieving the balance that we all seek them to achieve, then I'm more than happy to consider that.
Okay, thank you. I'm not sure if the officials want to come in, if Amy Kirkpatrick wanted to come in there.
We work very closely with our colleagues in licensing, and we're more than happy to work with them on anything you suggest, but as the Minister says, it's not work isn't ongoing currently on this. I'm aware that licensing colleagues are working on updated guidance for the licensing boards, which I think hopefully will alleviate some of these concerns.
That's very helpful, thank you. Can I bring in Paul O'Kane, who has some questions on this?
Thank you very much, Convener. I suppose my question is really focused on the online purchase of alcohol, I suppose, and how do we further perhaps regulate that? I think it's something that obviously became, you know, more and more prevalent during pandemic, during lockdown periods. And certainly, you know, people can buy alcohol from Amazon, they can buy it from online sites. They can obviously, we saw relaxation of licensing rules to allow pubs and venues to actually deliver to people's homes. So I really just wanted to get a sense from the Minister of perhaps where, if there's any work that's going to be done to, I suppose, review the impact of online sales and what they contribute in terms of overall percentage.
So I think you're absolutely right. It's an area of growth, and the pandemic has shifted our behaviour at a population level in a way that we wouldn't quite have imagined. And that's happened with food as well. So we're consuming in a different way to the way that we consume before. I mean, so premises like pubs and things that are selling alcohol online have to have a license, and they have to get a premises license through the licensing board within the area where the premises are located. So they do still have a licensing process to go through. I agree we need to consider how much alcohol, we need to understand how much alcohol is being bought from large national retailers like Amazon. Much of the online world is, the regulation is reserved to Westminster, and we went over when during the passage of the recent bill through Parliament. I'll ask Amy to come in on this perhaps. We went over whether, quite carefully, whether online sales could be considered a public health issue rather than an online sales issue. And the UK government was quite keen to consider it as online sales rather than as a public health issue. We will continue to look at that. I mean, I think, again, if I think about what's happened over the course of certainly the first year of the pandemic, we do need a little bit more understanding of just exactly how consumer habits changed and what happened in order to ensure that particular, you know, strategy of reduced availability isn't completely undone by online sales and ordering from Amazon in the morning and getting it delivered to your house in the evening. I'm not sure if Amy has anything more to say on this. I think most of the discussion on that particular bill was around food online sales rather than alcohol online sales, but it's a growing trend across the board.
Yeah, I think it is a very complicated area, especially since a lot of it is reserved to the UK government's vote. Our ability to make impact there is limited. It is one of the areas that we are considering as part of the consultation that's due to be published later in the year. We are trying to work through, you know, what could be done and what that would look like. So that'll be out later in the year.
I'm going to bring in Emma Harper. There's another issue as well with online sales, is that if you sign up to a regular, you know, like a wine club or whatever, you will never stop getting promotions. For people that are having a problem with their drinking and they want to move on from the drinking and stop drinking altogether, this constant marketing, they will never take you off a list. You're constantly, that must be really, really difficult for a lot of people. And I accept that that's not perhaps in the powers of the Scottish government.
But you're absolutely right to think of it that way. I mean, the World Health Organization talks about the three best buys being availability, affordability and attractiveness. And those wine clubs or cider clubs or whiskey clubs, you know, gin clubs, we've seen many different versions of the same thing. They absolutely target both the availability and the attractiveness. So you get a great deal of marketing around them. And of course, it's there in your house without any effort, delivered to your home every month, every 6 weeks, whatever the frequency is. So that does encourage more drinking and more alcohol. And we definitely need to think about things like that. And as I said, we aren't going to shift our relationship with alcohol and suddenly overnight by just pulling one lever. And also there is going to be things that come along that change our habits. So the pandemic was one thing that completely changed almost everyone's behaviour overnight. We don't know whether those changes are going to stick or not. Other things that happen, so when we, you know, these like wine clubs and things, I mean, I don't recall anyone when I was growing up being a member of a wine club, but it's not uncommon now. And, you know, online tastings and things like that. So the world has changed and we are going to need to keep looking at how our behaviour has changed and keep ensuring that the measures that we are using are keeping us in the healthy zone. We're not aiming for abstinence. We're not aiming for zero alcohol in Scotland. We're aiming for healthy drinking and a healthy relationship with alcohol. Yeah. And we just need to keep an eye on how behaviour changes going forward.
Emma, I'm going to bring you in.
Thanks, convener. It's just a quick sup to what Paul's original question was. You know, other countries in Europe have gone through the pandemic as well, and we obviously need to look at what other countries are doing and learn from them as well about whether they have changed
alcohol consumption habits during the pandemic, and then what are they doing as well? So I'm interested to hear from the Minister how we are learning from the other countries, how we are working with them, because in the World Health Organization's, you know, global challenges for alcohol harms and prevention, we need to learn from other countries. So I'd be interested to hear a wee bit of feedback about that.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'll perhaps bring Amy in here again to just supplement what I say. But we're always, as a government, we're always looking around the world to see, to get ideas and to think how to solve problems. Things that happen in Scotland are rarely unique to Scotland. What is clear, though, is that Scotland does have a really troubled relationship with alcohol, and we have had it for some time. And that, you know, if you remember back to the discussion around introduction of minimum unit pricing, one of the reasons that we were able to safely chart our way through the various legal challenges of that was that it was clear that we had more of a problem than most people. And most other countries, and we have to understand that we probably need to do more to get our relationship on a healthy footing than most other countries in the world. Alcohol consumption is really cultural, and it's really interesting when you look at different countries. So alcohol is much more available in, for example, Italy. It's much more common to drink along with food, but it's often smaller quantities, and it's almost always with food. The way that we drink in Scotland is quite different. The availability, if you look at the Scandinavian countries, they equally had a very difficult relationship with alcohol and brought in quite serious legislation around licensing and availability. So you have to go to a specific shop to buy alcohol. And, you know, of course, we've all heard stories about just how expensive a pint of beer is in Norway, although they do all get paid very well. So that just shows you the issue around affordability. So we are absolutely happy to look at other countries, but it's quite a complex picture, and we have to be careful not to just think, oh, that's an easy solution or that's an easy win here. We need to think about the Scottish context and how it would apply. I mean, one of the areas that we're looking very carefully at the moment is the issue of alcohol marketing and sport. And we are looking very carefully at what happened in France, because it's quite clear that the legislation that they brought in there, that some of the alcohol companies are getting around it by using. So if I give the example of, without saying the brand of the alcohol, they're using perhaps the font that is closely associated with that alcohol in their advertising around the stadium, and everybody sees that. It's not actually an advert for the alcohol, but it does make you think, oh, about that brand. The connection is there in your head. So we're looking very carefully at how that legislation has landed in France and what we might need to do to close that loophole before it's exploited. It's complicated and cultural, and it's going to take some time for us to unpick. I do think we're in, you know, we've a long way to go, but we have been for some years now headed in the right direction until the pandemic hit.
Okay, another area that we'd like you to consider is social responsibility levy, and questions from Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Camina. We've heard from previous witnesses about the benefits of introducing a social responsibility levy on alcohol retailers, and Alcohol Focus Scotland are in favour of an alcohol harm prevention tax, which would be linked to the volume of pure alcohol sales and which could be used to offset the harms caused by alcohol. The Scottish Government has previously said it won't implement measures such as a responsibility levy. Can the Minister clarify, until the wider economic circumstances are right, can the Minister clarify what the right economic circumstances would look like, and do you recognise the benefit of an alcohol harm prevention tax?
So I have to say, the minimum unit pricing of alcohol was the route that we went down, and I know there was a lot of discussion about the time about whether the tax aspect of that, whether that money should come back to be spent on treatment and prevention. Part of the reason that that's landed well is because it didn't affect the livelihoods of those people selling alcohol, and it didn't impact on the industry. You know, there's a lot of industry, alcohol industry in Scotland. So actually, increasing or decreasing affordability without impacting on the wider economy is quite a sophisticated way to tackle it. I think we need to look at what the impact of minimum unit pricing has been, and we need to understand how that has, the impact that it's had and how it's changed behaviour. And that will require us to wait just a little longer for the full evaluation of that. I would definitely keep the possibility of a social levy under review. I'm interested in anything and everything that I can do to tackle this challenge. But I don't think, and it's not particularly around affordability, I think we need to better understand the impact of minimum unit pricing, which, you know, acts in the same way. And that would be the two strands of it. One, whether it works, and secondly, reviewing the actual unit price before we could consider introducing a different taxation to tackle the same issue.
Sue Webber has a question on this.
Thank you very much, Convener. It sort of does feed on from what Gillian Mackay was saying there, Minister. It's been revealed that one of the impacts of minimum unit pricing has been that Scottish consumers have contributed £270 million more than was projected in terms of their spend on alcohol now. With what consideration has the Scottish Government given to the possibility of ring-fencing proceeds from alcohol rehabilitation and treatment as the current model feeds the revenue straight back into the supply chain?
Yeah, so certainly we're open to considering that. And that's why I say, you know, we need to look very closely at what's happened with minimum unit pricing. And one of the things that we need to look at is, you know, we carefully crafted it so that it wouldn't harm the economy and it wouldn't harm employment opportunities and local shops and things. But if what's happened is that they are getting a windfall from it, then I think we need to consider that going forward. But what I would say strongly is that we need to better understand exactly what is happening on the ground before we make a decision on our next steps. I'm really not averse to the potential for a social responsibility levy, and I'm willing to consider it. I just don't think that that this is the appropriate time to do it.
We're going to give over the rest of our time with you in this session to talking about treatment. First part of our scrutiny here is about ABIs and questions from Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning again, Cabinet Secretary. We heard evidence about alcohol grief interventions and about what they mean for people. And that should be or could be an easy win for addressing poor health outcomes related to alcohol. And is that something that we, obviously we've got more evidence about how alcohol brief interventions are working? And how do we support like a variety of opportunities for the ABIs to take place?
So I think you're absolutely right. I think ABIs are a really useful tool. They're short, evidence-based, structured conversations about alcohol consumption. And they're non-confrontational, they're motivating, they're supportive. So they're really attractive tools for health professionals and potentially others to use just opportunistically when there's a chance to have a chat. And it can potentially really reduce the risk of harm from alcohol. We began a piece of work on assessing, reviewing the evidence on the current delivery of alcohol brief interventions. But that was yet another piece of work that was impacted by the pandemic. So Public Health Scotland were carrying out that work for us and wanted to look at how it could better meet the needs of individuals. So we're just picking that work up again. We're keen to, we've established or are establishing a revised strategy group to review and discuss the evidence with the purpose of developing new recommendations on how best to take them forward in Scotland. The terms of reference for that group are being finalised, and Public Health Scotland will be the secretariat.
Emma?
Just to pick up on, I guess to clarify, are the general practitioners or GP practices, they're no longer incentivised to deliver alcohol brief interventions? So does that mean then we do have to think about alternative ways of delivering ABIs in order to, you know, because often we talk about the GP or the practice nurse, that's the first port of call for many people that alcohol might not be what their issue is, but it could be leading to whatever health issue they've now got symptoms that need to be addressed. So how do we help support that wider, I suppose, GP practices to deliver ABIs if they're not being incentivised anymore?
So certainly we're reviewing the evidence as a whole. We'll look at what currently happens in practice. I mean, I suppose the way that people access general practice and primary care has changed significantly over the course of the pandemic as well. We're looking quite carefully at who is best placed to deliver ABIs, where people are accessing help and support, where these conversations might happen, whether it might be other members of the primary care team other than the GP. Very keen to look at all of that going forward and come up with some recommendations that will help support the use of alcohol brief interventions, which I think most people agree are quite a useful strategy for opening up conversations and beginning the process of motivation towards change. So we'll see what we can do.
So you have a question? Oh, apologies, Emma. Sorry.
Just a final week. Obviously, the pandemic has affected alcohol like intake, and obviously it's affected how we then support and deal with people. And I remind everybody that I am still a nurse, and so I'm interested about how has the pandemic affected ABIs, and then what have we learned from that we can do ABIs differently. And we know, like, I'm thinking of attend anywhere near me kind of video interventions as well.
I know. So if I'm honest, we don't actually know. The last year that we have data available for is 2019 to 20. So it's just before the pandemic hit. What we saw there was that there were 75,616 ABIs that year, which was 23% more than the previous year. It's 23% more than the standard that we asked people to aim for. But we do need a fuller picture of what's happened with ABIs over the course of the pandemic. I mean, you'll know from previous, I'm a huge fan of Near Me. I think there is a real opportunity to use that technology. I think of alcohol brief interventions can be a useful tool virtually as well as in person. We'll try to get the evidence to make sure that is supported going forward.
And Sue?
Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Following up on that, Minister, we've already heard that the alcohol-related deaths are increasing, and they've increased 10% since 2020. And you've also said, in terms of ABIs, the last year of data we had was 2019-2020, when you said there was a 23% increase than what the standard is that you expect. But in the period between 2013 to 2020, there's actually been a 28% decline in the number of alcohol brief interventions, and we've heard that you're reviewing evidence and tackling, but what can we do immediately? What can we do in the short term to really, really uptick again those ABIs, which are so critical, particularly in those in the deprived areas?
So the work that's going on with Public Health Scotland to review ABIs began prior to the COVID pandemic, and it will reflect on the experience of the pandemic across Scotland, and those actions are actually well underway, so I'm expecting them to be able to report. I'm expecting that the strategy group will be convened summer this year. In terms of immediate actions and immediate levers that you can pull, I think it's it's difficult because we don't quite understand what happened or what the barriers were. I mean, I think we really need to understand what led to those, that increase in deaths and that increase in deaths right across the UK before we know what's going to be effective at reducing that in future. We also need to understand if it's something that's going to be repeated, if it was a consistent behaviour change, or if it's something that's just a one-off. So I think it's frustrating. I'm desperate to solve this problem. I'm really keen to do what we can. I feel it is urgent. I feel every single one of these deaths is a tragedy, but we need to better understand the situation before charting our way forward, I think.
We are now going to go on to general treatment of alcohol harms. Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister. It isn't easy to track overall spending on alcohol and drug deaths. Services. Can the Minister provide an update on funding for alcohol services, including a breakdown of contributions from all partners?
I can. I agree. I mean, I think the government acknowledges that it isn't easy to track the spending, and we're keen to improve that, would be the first thing to say. I think Angela Constance has responded to that audit report in the chamber. We want people to understand where the money is going and what outcomes we are expecting and achieving from it. Scottish Government gives health boards £53.8 million a year in baseline funding. And that is passed on from health boards to alcohol and drug partnerships. And that supports alcohol and drug treatment and recovery services at a local level. So as well as that, in 2020 to 2021, the Scottish Government's allocated an additional £17 million to ADPs by continuing the commitment that was made in the 2017-18 programme for government to improve the provision and the quality of services for those with problem drug and alcohol use. Now, as well as that, we're undertaking a whole range of work that's specifically to improve alcohol treatment services across Scotland, including the development of a public health surveillance system and the implementation of the UK-wide clinical guidelines for alcohol treatment. We've also invested in, and I think I've mentioned it before, the Simon Community Scotland have established a small-scale managed alcohol programme in Glasgow, and we're providing funding of £212,000 over 3 years for that pilot and for that evaluation. We also, Scottish Government provides funding to a number of third sector stakeholders, so Alcohol Focus Scotland, Scottish Health Action and Alcohol Problems, Scottish Alcohol Counselling Consortium, to develop their vital work. And I suppose the final thing to mention is the National Drugs Mission. So these two things are not separate. Services on the ground are delivered usually by alcohol drug partnerships. People go to the same services. So the investment of £100 million, which is being invested by the National Drugs Mission over the length of this parliament, so £250 million is being invested by the National Drugs Mission over the course of this parliament. £100 million of that is directly to residential rehab, of which I think in the last year, if you looked at the data, 45% of the people accessing residential rehab had alcohol problems, about 20% had combined drug and alcohol problems. So that investment also benefits this population.
Thanks for that, Minister. There is obviously a balance between the Scottish Government focusing on drug and alcohol services, and some witnesses felt that there was more of a focus on drugs and drug deaths at the present time. How can the Scottish Government ensure that alcohol services get its share of resources at local level?
So we're very, very aware of that. And myself and Angela Constance work very closely together, and our officials work very closely together. And in fact, I'll ask perhaps my officials to come in on this and explain just how that works. We recognise that there is learning for us from the work that's so in alcohol, we recognise there's learning coming from the National Drugs Mission that we need to apply in exactly the same way to our services for alcohol. Our services, you know, some of the criticisms that are made that they're not person-centred, that they don't respond rapidly enough, those could equally and easily be made about our alcohol services. And we're determined to learn the same lessons going across. The other thing is that just the way that things are structured in and delivery of treatment for alcohol problems and delivery for treatment of drug problems happens in the same location usually. These services are co-located, they're often the same services. So the investment in one will benefit investment in the other. One of the pieces of work that we've done jointly, which is actually quite successful, was the work to tackle stigma. So stigma is a problem in treatment of both areas, and actually taking a joint approach on that issue has proved quite helpful. And I think we had an advertising campaign recently which we've talked about stigma, which covered both alcohol and drugs, and I think it landed quite well. And will make a difference to the perception. We're very keen. You know, at core, we want a patient-centred public health approach, rights-based approach. We want people to be able to access these services easily and for there to be no judgment as they do so. And that applies across the board in addiction. So we're keen to learn lessons. And very keen to, certainly, you know, the work that's gone on around the medication-assisted treatment, I think that will be helpful when we have our UK clinical guidelines for alcohol treatment in terms of how do we implement them, how do we make sure that this quickly is adopted and happens on the ground. But I'll ask, I think, Maggie to come in and say a little bit more as she is in the drug team.
Just at the time, we only have 10 minutes left and we have a couple of members wanting to ask questions, so I'll bring in Maggie and move on to questions from Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you, Convener. I'll be brief. Just to follow up on what the Minister said there, there's a number of areas that we work very closely between the alcohol team and the drugs team at an official level. Specifically, work around workforce, which has been taken forward by the National Mission, is looking at workforce for both alcohol and drug services. Similarly, with lived experience and the whole family approach framework, both apply to both, and stigma, as the Minister already said, as well as obviously residential rehab, which is a £100 million commitment from the National Mission funding. And around half of people so far who've in this year who've been funded to go to residential rehab placement have been for alcohol specifically. But the other interesting point I think that we shouldn't lose sight of is that quite a lot of people are presenting to services with problems of both alcohol and drugs. So we have to look at these things in the round because they're not differentiated at the level of the service user in many cases.
Thank you, Maggie. Sandesh.
Thank you. There we go. Thank you. I think it's important the Minister has said that the drug and alcohol service are often co-located, and that's almost always the case. And I think the patients going to residential rehab, some of the survey, the work that we've done, has shown that they've dropped out because they were unwilling to wait longer. And I'm sure, as the Minister knows, that when patients present wanting help, they often have a small window because they often have chaotic lives. They might lose stability. The want to achieve abstinence wanes over time. And I'm sure the Minister has also seen that the Scottish Conservatives have published the Right to Recovery consultation with 77% of respondents being supportive. So would the Minister agree here to seriously look at our proposals and to support them?
So certainly... I actually don't think that consultation has been published yet, or certainly it hadn't at 4:30 on Friday. But I've seen the media around it. I'm not aware that the consultation, I think that we ran into the holiday weekend before it managed to get published in full. We'll be poring over that information, and we're very interested in the approach that's been proposed in that bill. We know that there's a mixture of views out there in society from stakeholders and from people with lived experience, quite keen to see how that consultation, which I expect to reflect those diverse views, then evolves into a bill. And then, of course, you know, we're more than happy to consider a bill when it comes forward to look at what your bill states and whether that is something that we can support for Scotland. We're very keen. I mean, much of, as I understand it, much of what the bill aims to do, we're already working on. So we're very keen that people would have a right to recovery. We're very keen that they should be able to make an informed decision about what treatment they have. I suppose there are some, you know, the way you framed your question there gave the impression that the Conservative Right to Recovery Bill is largely about residential rehab, and you know, I would be very clear that people need to have access to a range of treatments rather than one. The goal of abstinence or, you know, harm minimisation, these goals need to be decided along with the person who is experiencing drug misuse. So I wouldn't say there's just one path or one goal in recovery. I think it's usually a long path and a bit of a windy one. So a whole suite of options need to be available to support people as they recover from addiction.
We must move on because we only have 5 minutes left, and Emma Harper needs to cover inequalities. Emma.
Just to, I guess, to hear from the Minister about how we're helping support tackling alcohol harm in terms of inequalities. In the SHAP briefing that we got, they specifically talked about how LGBT community, LGBT people use and misuse alcohol in different ways, and that sometimes they felt that the services that were available were basically focused on heterosexual people, and sometimes the services maybe needed to have a more person-centred and holistic approach. So it's basically just how do we help support reducing alcohol harm in harder to reach groups and in areas where there is higher inequalities?
So that's a really excellent question, Emma. Thank you. So SHAP have done some really interesting work in a couple of areas and inequalities, just published studies last month. So they have the one on LGBTQ+, but they also had the one from Dundee University, which looked at the deep end practice nurses, alcohol nurses and deep end practices, which particularly targeted socioeconomic deprivation. The evidence around the LGBTQ plus is that particular community experience more alcohol harm. They use alcohol in a different way. There's probably a number of reasons for that, but you know, being a minority that faces hostility and discrimination would likely influence drinking behaviour. There's also the historical issue that safe places for people were often bars and clubs. So we have to, as a society, reflect on that piece of learning and think about how we can change that going forward. And in terms of, you know, most of the recommendations about making services inclusive were for people delivering services on the ground. And, you know, I absolutely support the work that's been done and the recommendations that have been made. And I'm quite keen that service delivery reflects this learning. I do hear from a number of groups that services don't look like they're for them. So as well as LGBTQ plus people, I mean, I think that study showed that most people's perception is that services are for middle-aged heterosexual men. So you have women feeling like they can't access services. You have young people feeling like they can't access services. So we really need to reflect on that. And, you know, we have a problem with alcohol right throughout society, and we really need our services to be inclusive and welcoming and help people, because it's quite hard to ask for help. So we need them to land when they come in.
Emma?
Just a final question. I represent a rural area, remote area, and I know you'll be very familiar with challenges in remote and rural as well. So can you maybe tell us a wee bit about how we're looking at tackling alcohol harms in remote and rural areas?
So you're absolutely right. As a Highland representative representing the most far north and quite sparsely populated in some parts of it, constituency, this is an area where we have a long history of alcohol harm. It's an area I'm very interested in. We definitely need to improve access in every part of Scotland. So all of these health inequalities that play out in our general health system, we need to be thinking about in terms of accessing alcohol treatment. So we need to look at geographical inequalities. We need to look at women. We need to look at poverty, and we need to look at LGBTQ+. We are absolutely keen to make sure, because this is a problem which occurs all over Scotland and perhaps to a greater extent in some of our more rural populations, absolutely our services need to be able to deliver in rural areas.
Thank you. And our final question in this session, Sue Webber.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Minister, specifically for drawing attention to the inequality that women face in terms of accessing services. That's 51% of the population are struggling to access services that are being developed, and I think that should probably be number one priority, given the makeup of this committee. Also, alcohol-related hospitalisations and deaths are 8 times higher in the most deprived areas of Scotland. That should be a shame for all of us. We really need to figure out how we can target and support these communities. Support mechanisms for alcohol misuse are often far more sparse in these deprived areas than they are in the most affluent areas, which you've also alluded to there. So what can we do to narrow that gap and really target into those deprived communities?
So I'm glad to have your allyship on the women. Of course, as Women's Health Minister, it would be remiss if I didn't highlight the health inequalities that women face. You're absolutely right. There's a stark social gradient in terms of alcohol harms, with those in the most deprived areas being the most affected. We need to take a whole population approach when we're tackling this and alcohol consumption and the risk of alcohol-related harms, and that will in turn drive reductions in alcohol harm in our most deprived communities. So these whole population measures, like minimum unit pricing of alcohol, will have an impact in those communities as well. They won't just affect them, they won't just affect rich people, they'll affect everyone and feel the benefit right across society. I mentioned the study by SHAP, which highlighted the effectiveness of alcohol nurses in the deep end practices in Glasgow. And these are nurses who support people with alcohol problems who have complex needs. And the Scottish Government's really keen to understand that. What we find is that some people really need effort put into ensuring that they are able to receive joined up services. So I think there are probably lessons to be learned across the board about improving access to services for everyone, but there's probably a particular population that we need to do something slightly different for. We need to reach out to them, we need to hold on to them, and we need to make sure that we don't let go until they're on a more healthy footing. And I think that's what that work was doing. So I'm very keen to explore that further. There's also, I mentioned the Simon Community Work, so that managed alcohol programme. Very small number of people, but it's particularly targeted at homeless people. And we're keen to get the learning from that to see if we can make a difference to that particular population. The final point to make, and we've had this discussion before, is that we need to think about what drives alcohol harm. So we need to tackle poverty. We need to tackle inequalities. We need to provide good quality, affordable housing. And we need to enable the best art of life for our children. And all of us should absolutely be laser focused on that when we're thinking about tackling alcohol.
Thank you.
Thank you. Minister, I want to thank you very much and your officials for your time this morning on this. Minister is going to be continuing to join us in our next part of our agenda, but we're going to take a 10-minute break and we'll return at 11:15. Thank you.
everyone. Welcome back. Our third item today is another evidence session with the Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport. And this session is focused on the Provisional Common Framework on Food Composition Standards and Labelling. Welcome again, Mithi Todd, Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport. And she is joined online by Jennifer Howie, the UK Frameworks and Intergovernmental Relations Lead for Food Standards Scotland. Thank you for staying on, Minister. I believe that you have an opening statement.
Certainly. Thanks very much. I want to thank the committee for inviting me here today to assist in their deliberations of the Provisional Common Framework for Food Composition Standards and Labelling. Officials in Food Standards Scotland have been working with their counterparts in DEFRA and the Food Standards Agency in Wales and Northern Ireland to develop a four nations approach to deliver repatriated EU functions on common areas of interest in the framework. The ministers of the four nations have agreed the content of this professional framework, which was published as a UK government command paper on the 17th of February 2022. Policy and food composition, standards and labelling were and continue to be highly regulated at EU level. The purpose of the framework is to ensure that there is a joined-up approach across the UK for the continued maintenance of high standards of safety through delivery of regulatory functions in this area. Throughout the process, we've committed to working collaboratively to develop common frameworks on the basis of consensus and in line with the agreed principles of the Joint Ministerial Committee on EU Negotiations. This includes the principle that UK frameworks should both ensure the functioning of the UK internal market as well as acknowledging the policy divergence, and that they should respect the devolution settlements and the democratic accountability of the devolved legislatures. Scottish ministers fully support the Common Framework programme and consider that frameworks are all that is needed to manage any potential legislative divergence in future. We consider that common frameworks provide necessary and proportionate assurance to respective governments, legislatures, consumers, citizens, industry on issues concerning public health, and that internal market issues are duly considered in food composition standards and labelling policy development but are not prioritised over consumer interests. I'm happy to answer the committee's questions.
Thank you, Minister. And this is one of quite a few common frameworks that certainly I have been looking at in over a period of time in the last few years since the exit from the EU. You say that the four UK partner governments have, you know, agreed on this, but we've just had a session where we've been talking about labelling for public health reasons to do with like alcohol labelling, whatever. Are there any? Can you tell us? Was there any areas of debate around this? Because obviously, public health goals in particular countries might be slightly different, or mechanisms that they feel or be appropriate to get to those goals around labelling. Was there any areas of debate around this ahead of you agreeing to the common framework?
So what the common framework provides is a way of working together, basically, and that does allow for divergence to occur. So as I said in my opening statement, we are confident that the common framework provides a useful way of managing these discussions, ensuring that there is early engagement, ensuring that we work together to try to achieve consensus, and that where divergence does occur, it doesn't take our neighbours by surprise. I think the most likely area of divergence here is that Scottish Government has Scotland generally wants to align itself with the EU. So if there is an area of EU food information law that changes, it is likely or possible that Scotland might want to align with the EU and the rest of the UK might not. Although, of course, Northern Ireland will have to align with the EU. So it's really just a way of working.
Within this common framework, in order for those discussions to be happening about anything happening in the future, and that there's space for scrutiny at parliamentary level as well for us to be able to keep abreast of what's happening in this space.
Absolutely. So the core purpose of the framework is to prevent disputes through close collaboration between the four UK nations whilst respecting the devolution settlement. So enabling policy divergence. And the aim of the framework is to avoid, where possible, the need to trigger the dispute resolution process. In terms of scrutiny, I think Parliament will engage with this framework through the decisions that it will be asked to take on any change of legislation proposed in this policy area. It's essentially a way of working. So this framework is essentially setting down the mechanisms for working together with the other administrations of the four UK nations that share these islands.
OK, thank you very much. Move on to talk about the domestic arrangements. Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. The framework commits the Scottish Government to making joint decisions about some food products that it would have previously had autonomy to regulate. Does the Minister have any concerns about whether this will impact the Government's ability to regulate food products on public health grounds, for example?
So I don't have concerns particularly about the framework. As I said, I think there's a healthy method there, a way of working in collaboration with the four UK nations and a way of resolving conflict and a way of enabling divergence should that be required. I have more concerns about the Internal Market Act on that front. The Internal Market Act tramples over devolution and, you know, was not consented to by either Scotland and Wales for exactly those reasons. And the public health concerns around the Internal Market Act were very well rehearsed as it passed through Parliament. So that piece of legislation concerns me. That may well constrain or weaken my ability to take public health action in Scotland, because products which are able to be sold in England will automatically be able to be sold in Scotland too.
Could you provide clarity about the dispute resolution process where differences occur, and are you satisfied that an effective process is in place?
I am satisfied that there is an effective process in place. Firstly, let me say I hope that we don't reach that point, you know, and actually for all the impression that is given that we are regularly in conflict with each other and these four nations, actually we work quite closely together on a number of issues across the board in health, and we have strong working relationships, particularly, I would say, in my portfolio. So I would expect us to be able to avoid triggering that conflict resolution process. I think I'll bring in Jennifer to talk a little bit more about the detail about how it will work should it be triggered. Jennifer.
Sure. Thank you, Minister. I think you've pretty much covered it. The intention is very much for officials to continue to work together.
Oh dear.
Okay. Jennifer has frozen. We'll maybe bring her back.
Essentially, there are different tiers of intervention, and we would expect much of this to be resolved at official level, as it currently is. So we would expect that to continue, and for ministers to be able to be pulled in to work together to resolve the issues should that be needed. But I would expect that to not happen on a very frequent basis.
Thank you. Okay. Move on to on the theme, managing divergence. Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you, Convener. In February, you spoke about how you were keen to remain aligned with EU law where such alignment is appropriate and in Scotland's best interest. Could you give any examples of where the government may choose to diverge from EU law?
So, in this policy area, probably I can't. And in fact, I guess Brexit's been a very recent phenomenon. So in terms of how our systems work, since we've left the EU, I think it would be quite difficult to think of examples since then. I think it is perfectly possible, if you think about how the structures work. So Food Standards Scotland advise us in government on safety of food products. And it may be that a different body in the EU body gives the EU different advice, and you know, we might decide to stick with the advice that we had gained in Scotland. It is possible. I mean, what I say is we will align with the EU where we possibly can. We, you know, Scotland is very clear that we did not want to leave the EU, and certainly this government is keen that we rejoin the EU as soon as we are an independent country. But meantime, that we will have structures in place which will give us independent advice, and we will make those decisions that are best for Scotland at this moment in time.
Sandesh, I'll move on then. Yep. Internal Market Act has already been alluded to, but we have some more detailed questions from David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener, and my favourite subject, Minister. What impact will the UK Internal Market Act have on Scots law on the food compositional standards and labelling?
So, in our analysis, and this is why it causes so much concern, the operation of the Internal Market Act means that irrespective of the necessity or the proportionality of any public health priority in Scotland or indeed any other part of the UK, any national measure could be caught and radically undermined by the automatic application of the Act's market access principles. So in place of a common framework that's designed to manage policy divergence by dialogue and agreement, we would just see the effect of automatic recognition of standards set elsewhere, regardless of the local circumstance, or the wishes of the relevant legislature or the policies of the relevant administration.
Thank you, Minister. In evidence to committee, Quality Meat Scotland argued that it's vital that a common framework should respect devolution settlements by allowing policy diversion. Does the Scottish Government intend to request any exclusions from the UK Internal Market Act in the policy area covered by this common framework?
So the framework, the Internal Market Act, although it came into power in 2020, it is still bedding in. I would say we are still trying to understand the impact of that piece of legislation on our public health decisions. I can't think of an example at the moment where I would be looking for exclusions, but if we get back to the topic of the framework, I mean, the framework does allow for divergence and it does respect the devolution settlement. So that would absolutely, for, you know, for public health reasons and for all reasons, that would be why we would prefer that mechanism for resolving divergence. Definitely.
Thank you. No further questions.
Evelyn, did you have some questions? And maybe before I come to Evelyn, just let the Minister know that, that Jennifer, your official, is back online, but sound only. I won't bring her back in just now, but just so that you know that she is there, should we need to refer to her. Evelyn.
The Minister has helpfully covered my areas. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you very much. And now move on to some questions around the Northern Ireland Protocol with Emma Harper. Emma.
Thanks, Convener. Yep, the Northern Ireland Protocol interests me because of the Port of Cairn Ryan and travelling for products and goods between Cairn Ryan, Scotland, and Larne and Belfast. And so I'm interested in the Northern Ireland Protocol and how the food compositional standards and labelling framework impacts on that or affects it. Under the UK-EU withdrawal agreement, Northern Ireland will remain in the UK, in the customs territory, but remain aligned with EU regulations. So that means that Northern Ireland has to basically do what the EU regulations require. And, you know, Scotland didn't vote to exit the European Union. So would there be an issue where Scotland could be part of the EU alignment regulations and still work the way that the Northern Ireland Protocol is intended as well? So that's something that I would be interested in pursuing, where if we did choose to continue to align with EU policy, we could basically work as part of a Northern Ireland Protocol.
So the framework is a four country agreement, and it was intended to drive consistent approaches right across the UK whilst acknowledging policy divergence. It's absolutely clear that any change to EU law will have to apply in Northern Ireland. So there will be divergence should the other countries in the UK choose not to align with the EU. So if England or Wales, and Scotland has a policy, an aim of remaining aligned with the EU, but should England and Wales choose to diverge, then there will be divergence across the UK. It's an inevitable consequence of our exit from the EU and the Northern Ireland Agreement. But this framework enables even that situation to be managed carefully in a way that will work so long as the policy options are undermined by robust evidence and the framework policies processes are followed. There's absolutely no reason why any divergence per se should undermine the framework. The framework enables divergence. It doesn't prevent it.
Emma, have you anything else to add?
No, I think that's okay. I'm again just concerned that if the framework allows or enables for divergence, so that means that then we'll be the framework supports the continuation of a Northern Ireland protocol that has been established to basically allow Northern Ireland to continue to be aligned with EU regulations.
So I
is
guess
that right?
Yeah, Northern Ireland will automatically align with EU regulations. That's what will happen in future, whereas Scotland will make a policy choice to align with EU regulations. I guess that's the difference.
Thank you.
Okay. All right, thanks.
Thank you, Emma. Final questions from Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, convener. It's back on again. Sorry, apologies. I wanted to ask you about the periodic and exceptional reviews. Does the Scottish Government have any concerns about those and how they're triggered, or is it something that you're quite happy with?
We are quite happy with it. I mean, the intention is to review the framework a year after implementation and at 3 years thereafter. It really is at heart just a document that describes a way of working healthily together and productively together. If there are any issues arising, that might be more about whether the framework was followed. You know, we're just all getting used to this new world, so it might be that the framework wasn't followed rather than the framework itself is faulty. So we need to let the processes bed in a little before we can fairly assess whether or not a review process is appropriate. But we'll certainly keep an eye on how these things work. We certainly intend. I mean, I think, as I said, you know, all four UK ministers are agreed that this is a reasonable way forward. I hope it does provide us with a way of working together that avoids conflict, and where conflict and divergence is necessary, it enables that as per the devolution settlement.
And can I just ask as well then, so how will the Scottish Parliament be able to contribute to the review process, and also other stakeholders, how will they be able to contribute as well? Is that something that's set up yet? Is there a process for that?
So there would be future discussions, I think, between Scottish Parliament and Scottish Government officials would definitely consider a possible approach to the post-implementation monitoring frameworks, but I would expect Parliament to be fully involved. There are individual review processes in place which are currently being developed, and I wonder if Jennifer wants to say a little bit more about this. FSS are responsible for three of those frameworks, and they'll collectively involve a whole number of departments right across the UK, and there's, you know, consultation with stakeholders and things, so about how to ensure that the process is well informed, try to cut out in duplication of effort on all four nations, but also to make sure that there is plenty of evidence coming forward to inform decisions. But I'll ask Jennifer to say a little bit more on that.
Jennifer.
Sure. I hope everybody can hear me, and apologies for my poor line, rural Aberdeenshire. Yes, I think it's fair to say there's probably a two-pronged sort of way of, you know, acting for stakeholders and the parliamentarians to scrutinise how well the frameworks are working, I guess. In terms of the output of the frameworks process, those will be items of draft legislation that come before Parliament. And if parliamentarians feel in respective legislatures that if there's an issue arising in relation to any specific item in terms of the consultation program, would be feedback potentially that way. In relation to the broader programme of frameworks that have been developed in the scripts themselves, Scottish Government officials are working with their Cabinet Office counterparts and in other administrations have been responsible for putting together the programme in terms of the detail of the following in portfolio areas. They are currently developing guidance in terms of potentially annual reports, for example, that might come before the Parliament in specific framework areas, whether they're singular or batched. As the Minister says, you know, we wouldn't want to be overburdening the legislatures with framework reports, but should those be forthcoming, which we would expect to be the case, then those reports as presented to Parliament would provide another opportunity for feedback. So, to say there's the output of specific issues in terms of draft legislative opportunities, which could include feedback on whether the process was considered to have been followed in relation to those items, and then more generally on the operation of the frameworks system. Discussions are ongoing across the administrations on the latter.
Okay, thank you very much. We did hear you, Jennifer, although a little bit patchy in areas, but we got the general gist. Minister, we have no more questions for you, so I want to thank you very much for the time you spent with us this morning on both agenda items. We'll have a minute or two suspension before to allow the Minister and her officials to leave before we move on to the next items on our agenda. Our fourth item on the agenda is consideration of two negative instruments. The first instrument is the National Health Service Superannuation and Pension Schemes Miscellaneous Amendments Scotland Regulations 2022. And this instrument makes changes to the employee contribution table from the 1st of April 2022, which updates the salaries, earnings bands on which the employee contribution percentages are set. The instrument also makes temporary modifications to the NHS Pension Scheme Scotland regulations, which have similar effect to Section 46 of the Coronavirus Act 2020. Following the expiry of the Coronavirus Act 2020, this instrument will temporarily extend those provisions until the 31st of October 2022. Section 46 of the Act suspends certain rules that apply in the NHS pension schemes in Scotland, so that NHS staff who've recently retired can return to work, and those who have already returned can increase their hours without there being a negative impact on their pension entitlements. Now, the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered this instrument at its meeting on the 26th of April 2022 and agreed to draw this instrument to the attention of the Parliament on the following grounds. First of all, the committee draws this instrument to the Parliament under the general reporting ground for a failure
to follow proper drafting practice, as provision should have been made for regulations 2 to 5 to have a retrospective effect rather than coming into force prior to the instrument being made. And the committee also draws this instrument to the attention of Parliament under reporting ground J for failure to comply with laying requirements in accordance with the laying requirements in section 28(2) of the Interpretation and Legislative Reform Scotland Act. So a couple of administrative points there. No motions to annul have been received in relation to this instrument. Do any members have any comments to make in relation to this instrument? Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you. And just a declaration of interest. I am an NHS doctor and indeed am in the pension scheme. I would have liked to have seen this go a bit further and help consultants and those in the NHS who cannot do extra work because of the pensions causing an issue, as we see in Wales. But I understand this is not part of this consultation.
Okay, thank you very much. We have any other comments from members? No, we don't. I propose, therefore, the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Does any member disagree with this? No, we are all agreed on that. And the second negative instrument is the National Health Service General Medical Services Contract and Primary Medical Service Section 17C Agreements, Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022. The purpose of this instrument is to require NHS boards to provide various services to support GP practices and require GP practices to have a practice website and offer certain online services to patients. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered the instrument at its meeting on the 26th of April 2022 and made no recommendations, and no motions to annul have been received in relation to this instrument. Do any members have any comments on this? Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you, Convener. And again, to declare my interest as an NHS doctor working in primary care, I would just like to put on record that whilst I'm supportive of us having more online access, I do want to ensure that people who struggle to get online do not feel that they're unable to access appointments, especially if they have become exclusively online, or the majority are, and so these are no longer available when they call in, and we do need to find ensure that we find a balance.
Yeah, and I think that most of us, all of us here, would be in agreement with that sentiment. If there's any other comments that people want to make, please let me know. Thank you. I propose, therefore, the committee does not make